This morning's message will hopefully be an encouragement. Some of the stuff probably not new to any of us, but it's good to be reminded, and it's good to study God's Word. Question for us this morning, when you think of Christian doctrines or teachings, what are some of the first ones that maybe come to mind? Faith? What's that? Justification? Resurrection? Yes, things like that. Maybe the divinity of Christ, baptism, grace. We've been focusing on fellowship for the last 3 weeks, and today is kind of the conclusion of that while Tom is gone. And I support, strongly believe in fellowship, and I participate in it. But if I had been asked that question about, you know, teachings, Christian teachings, important doctrines, fellowship wouldn't have made the list. Not because I don't think it's important, I just don't think about it. And maybe it's because we don't talk about that a lot, I don't know. But fellowship is not a secondary or a marginal Christian teaching. Or part of our Christian walk. In fact, it's one of the most important parts of our lives as disciples of Christ. So then you might be asking, well, so what's the big deal about fellowship? Why is it so important? Why should we want it? And to answer that, we have to go back to the Garden of Eden and to Adam and Eve. And actually, we have to go a little bit before that, 6 days, to before creation. In the beginning, what does it say? God created the heavens and the earth. God, the word for God in Hebrew is Elohim. And the reason that's even important is because Elohim is plural. And so that means God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, created the heavens and the earth. They were in fellowship together. They were in perfect unity together. And what was the first evidence that we have of their unity? For us, anyways. They created the heavens and the earth. They participated together, shared together, in creating this earth and the heavens. What was the last thing that they created? James Howie said that to me after service. And you could say that to us. Figuratively speaking, because he said we shall rest, but the last thing, us, man, Adam and Eve, when he created them, he said, let us make man in what? Our image. And so we have to understand then, as part of being created in their image, that part of being creative in their image is fellowship. If we're created in their image, then we are created for fellowship both with one another, but created also for fellowship with them. We see that exactly, we see that take place in the garden, this fellowship, the idea of fellowship, when we see that God was present when he brought the animals to Adam to name them so that he could find that there was no suitable helper. We see it, God present when he took a rib from Adam and made a woman and brought that woman to Adam. We see that Adam and Eve were at least familiar with God's voice because it says that they heard his voice as he was walking through the garden. What did they do then? They hid. But it's one of those evidences that of fellowship is that they knew his voice. In the beginning then, Adam and Eve had fellowship with one another, and they had fellowship with God. When Adam and Eve sinned, though, all fellowship was broken, both fellowship with God and fellowship with one another. What would be one of the first examples you could think of that would show fellowship broken between each other, between men. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. What's that? Yeah. That Cain and Abel is one of the first ones I would have thought of. I didn't even think of that's a that's exactly. But even before that, well, I guess the one I'm thinking of is after Adam would have blamed God, is what Adam and Eve did. They realized they were naked, and then they made coverings for themselves. It's almost as if they were putting barriers, and that's so not defines, but describes how we often are. We have barriers. We don't let people a lot of times really see what's in our, you know, the things that we're struggling with, our weaknesses, our insecurities, our hurts. We have these barriers. Fellowship has been broken. Now, in saying that, I'm not suggesting that as our fellowship grows, that our wardrobe should shrink. No, that would be like the Emperor's New Clothes thing, story. But what I am suggesting is that the point is that as our fellowship grows, our barriers should come down. We should come to a point where we are vulnerable with one another, being able to share hurts, insecurities, struggles, so that we can bear one another's burdens and we can encourage one another. Despite this broken fellowship that was caused by us, God didn't abandon us, did he? Instead, he illustrates his desire for fellowship by not abandoning us, but by killing an animal and clothing Adam and Eve properly with this animal. The shedding of blood to make atonement for sin and the giving of new clothing, those are both shadows of things to come, and we will see how those play out in a little bit. Broken fellowship and its implications for our world are also is also not a marginal teaching or thing in the scriptures. Have you ever heard somebody say, I forget how it goes, your walk doesn't match your talk, or your walk doesn't match your talk, or whatever it is. Well, it was specific. James Howie had told me after the service a different way, but make your walk match your talk, or something. Yeah. That whole thing. So what do we mean when we say walk? We're not talking about walking. We're talking about the way that we live, the way that we act. I kind of skipped a spot. Sorry. I'm going to have to backtrack a little bit. But the whole idea of broken fellowship brings up the question of, are people basically good? And you've probably heard that, somebody say that. I know I've heard it. We were watching a movie just this last week, somebody saying that. But if you've ever been part of the foster care system, you know that people are not basically good. Children who are abused, neglected, abandoned by the very ones that should be nurturing them and loving them and protecting them. This last week, his house was participating in the End It movement. What is it that the movement is trying to end? Sex trafficking. People, women, boys and girls who are tricked or coerced or forced into the worst kind of slavery. This last week, I attended a FAN meeting, which is Families Against Narcotics. And I knew that drugs are a problem in this community, but I didn't realize how bad. And one of the things that really was disturbing is hearing about how people that, at least in my mind, I think of as, I don't know, more good, let senior citizens participate in the problem by selling their unused prescriptions to people who are dealers who collect from such people, and then they take those unused prescriptions and sell them individually. And young people who are now experimenting at the age of 10 or 11 are becoming addicted and their lives messed up for years, even overdosing. So we have, I mean, those are just examples that we're not basically good. But then, you know, that's kind of like them, because we're not doing any of those things, but how many of us would want a video camera following us 24/7? Not me. Because why? Because they might capture us speaking with cutting sarcasm, speaking with hate and anger, maybe slandering, maybe they would catch us acting in selfish ways, in arrogant ways. So we are not basically good, and we do live in a dark world. And it's worse because it's a dark world that's in fellowship with Satan. And what is Satan described as? The roaring lion, roaming to and fro, seeking whom he may devour. So that's kind of the bad news picture. The good news is we don't actually need to stay in the darkness. And many of us already realize that, and we've already entered into the light. We don't have to walk in fear of that lion that's roaming around. God, who is light, and in whom there is no darkness at all, desires for us to have fellowship with him, and that he desires that we walk with him in the light. The question then for us this morning is, how do we enter into that fellowship, and how do we stay there? The first the first thing I want to address is how we can enter into fellowship with the Lord, with God, and that's by entering the water, by being immersed, by being baptized. And I know that some people object to the teaching that baptism saves us, or that it has any role in us being restored in fellowship with God, because they see baptism as a work, as something that we do. And they do correctly point out that we are saved by grace, by God's doing. And I know you've had discussions or heard that talked about. But what we're going to see is that baptism isn't about us. And baptism isn't even about our obedience, although obedience is required. Baptism is about what God does through baptism. God mediates, or God imparts certain things through the water to us. Things like salvation, things like a new family, things like a new clothing, things like a purification or sanctification, things, and most importantly, fellowship with him. On the day of Pentecost, when Peter preached to the Jews in Jerusalem and helped them to understand that it was them who had crucified the Messiah that they were promised, the same Messiah that God had made both the Lord and Christ, says that they were pierced to the heart. And I was thinking about this, if there was anybody that you would think of as having broken fellowship with God, it would be the ones who by their voice, by their actions, physically put Jesus to death on the cross. And so what was their response? What shall we do? And what was Peter's response to their question? It says what they should do was repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of sins and for the gift of the Holy Spirit. This baptism that Peter spoke about and that he preached to the Jews, like most teachings, is foreshadowed in the Old Testament. And so we're going to take a little look at the Old Testament. One of the greatest examples that I could think of this foreshadowing is the story of the Israelites. The Israelites were living in Egypt, and Egypt was like a symbol of darkness. They were in slavery in Egypt. God led the Israelites out of Egypt by his servant Moses, and I was thinking about this too. Moses was a foreshadow or a type of Christ, and he himself prophesied in Deuteronomy 18. He says, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your countrymen. You shall listen to him." And just this morning I was thinking about that, how much that sounds like when Peter and James and John were with Jesus on the mountain and Elijah and Moses appeared and they got all excited and wanted to build shelters for all three of them. What did God say from the cloud? "This is my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased." And then he said, "Listen to him, hear him." So we are like the Israelites. We once lived in darkness, as the Apostle Peter says in 1 Peter. And by the way, I have the scriptures, that most of the scriptures up there, so you can kind of be turning ahead as I'm going through. 1 Peter 2:9 says, "But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light." So we are, compared to the Israelites who were living in darkness and slavery and who God brought out of there. Where did God take them? Where did they go after Egypt? They went through the Red Sea, right? What did God accomplish in the Red Sea? He accomplished complete deliverance from the power of darkness and sin that was represented by Egypt. And how did he do that? By completely destroying Pharaoh and Pharaoh's army in the sea. What is the first promise that was given to us, that if we would repent and be baptized, it was that we should have forgiveness of sins, right? And what is it that Jesus accomplished? He accomplished on the cross complete victory over sin and death. And that is imparted to us when we go through the water. The parallel continues. Where did they go after the Red Sea? God took them where? Took them to the holy mountain, Mount Sinai. And his purpose in taking them there was to establish the covenant with them and to give them his law so that they might live holy, that he might purify and sanctify them. For what purpose? It was so that he could dwell with them. He could be in their midst. What is the second promise that is given to us if we repent and are baptized? That we are given the gift of the Holy Spirit. That we can have God's presence dwelling inside of us. And then finally, the parallel continues. The ultimate destination of the Israelites was where? The promised land. And what is our ultimate destination? The promised land, which we look to as heaven. And the whole point of all this, the ultimate purpose of all this, is restored fellowship with God. Another foreshadowing of baptism comes from the priesthood. I found this really interesting. In being set apart as priest, the very first, setting apart of Aaron and his sons, and then continuing on for them to continue as priests, they had to remove their clothes and wash their bodies and then put on their priestly garments to be able to go in and offer the sacrifices. This was not for a physical cleaning, but this was for a ritual purification. It was a spiritual thing. There are two important aspects of this for us to take note of. The first one is the ritual purification. And we see kind of how this is foreshadowed and into the New Testament. In 1 Peter 3, if you want to read along, 1 Peter 3, 18 through 22, it says, "For Christ also died for sins, once for all, the just for the unjust, in order that he might bring us to God." And there again we have the purpose is that he might bring us to God. We might be in his presence. "Having put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which also he went and made proclamation to the spirits now in prison, who were once disobedient when the patience of God kept waiting in the days of Noah during the construction of the ark, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were brought safely through the water. And corresponding to that, baptism now saves you, not the removal of dirt from the body, but an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who is at the right hand of God, having gone into heaven after angels and authorities and powers had been subjected to him. So you notice, just as the priest washed for this ritual purification and cleansing, so we are baptized, as this is said, is not for removing the dirt from our bodies. It's for the purification that only God can impart. It's a spiritual thing. But one of the things that was really interesting to me was that the priest, they had to do this purification, this washing, daily, because they would offer sacrifices daily. And they had to offer sacrifices daily because why? Because the blood of bulls and goats and sheep could never remove sin. But Christ became the perfect sacrifice, and so now we, in becoming, as what we read earlier in Hebrews, having become a holy priesthood, how many times do we have to wash? Once. We only need to be baptized once. So the priest, because the sacrifices would never cover sin, they had to continually offer sacrifices, continually all had to wash themselves to come into the presence of God to offer those sacrifices. But Christ was able to offer for one time a sacrifice to cover all sin. And so when we only need be washed once. And then the Holy Spirit, we are able to continually have his presence within us. The other important aspect of the priests washing themselves is that they put on priestly garments. Do you remember Adam and Eve, how they had made coverings for themselves, but then God killed an animal and made coverings for them from the animal's skin? It was the first recorded shedding of blood. And the animal's blood was shed because of Adam and Eve's sin. And that shed blood, that animal's life, provided the covering for Adam and Eve. In Galatians 3, we see how that's foreshadowed and completed, rather. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There's neither slave nor free. There's neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ. So when we are baptized, we are washed, just as the priests were washed, but we don't clothe ourselves with any priestly man-made garments. Rather, we are clothed with Jesus Christ. And what is the result of that? It's fellowship. There's no longer different nationalities, no longer different social statuses, no longer different genders. We are supposed to be one with Christ. In order for us to have fellowship with one another, those barriers had to be removed, and Christ removed them. Or at least, well, he removed them, but we have to actually recognize that in our fellowship. The second way is not about how we enter in fellowship, but rather how we can stay in fellowship with God. 1 John 1, 5 through 7. This is the message we have heard from him and announced to you, that God is light and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Apostle John makes it very clear that in order for us to have fellowship or to be in fellowship with God, we must also be walking in the light. And this is where I was supposed to ask, what do we mean when we say your walk doesn't match your talk? And basically, our walking in the light or walking in the darkness is about how we're living. Are we living in ways that are of this world, that are of Satan, or are we living in ways that are of God? If we continue on, go ahead a few verses into the second chapter, verses 3 through 6. And by this we know that we have come to know him, if we keep his commandments. The one who says, I have come to know him, and does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, in him the love of God has truly been perfected. By this we know that we are in him. The one who says he abides in him ought himself to walk in the same manner as he walked. We can know that we have come to know Christ. And how is it that we know that we have come to know Christ? If we obey his commandments, if we keep his word. And we know we are in him if what? If we walk as he walked. In other words, if we live as he lived. Verses 9 through 11. The one who says he is in the light and yet hates his brother is in the darkness until now. The one who loves his brother abides in the light, and there is no cause for stumbling in him. But the one who hates his brother is in the darkness and walks in the darkness and does not know where he is going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. When Jesus was asked what was the greatest commandment, what was his response? Yes, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind. And the second was like it, love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend the whole law and the prophets. If you love God and your neighbor, you will obey God's commands for how we should worship him, how we should serve him, how we should relate and behave with others. And after Jesus gave those two greatest commandments, he summarized it for the one who said, well, who is my neighbor? And what was that explanation? It was that the neighbor was the Samaritan who showed love to the Jew who hated Samaritans. So not only does he tell us who our neighbor is, but he also shows us what love is. If we only love those who love us back, what kind of love is that? I stole that quote from the movie Woodlawn. Encourage you to watch it. What's that? Woodlawn. So the New Testament is full of instruction about how we should walk or how we should live in the light. The passage in Ephesians 5 you can read later, but I was thinking how one passage in Corinthians sums it up. The fruit of the Spirit. The Spirit within us should produce what? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, self-control. That's what we should see as we're walking in the light. So finally, the third way that we can continue in fellowship with God is by sitting at the table, by participating in the Lord's Supper. So what are some differences that you probably have experienced in different congregations? I know there's people from different backgrounds, different practices in the Lord's Supper. Yes, some practice it monthly, some once a year, some bi-monthly and weekly. Some use a whole loaf of bread, others use a round wafer, and some use a chiclet-sized piece of bread. Some use a single cup that everybody drinks from together. Some actually dip the bread in the cup. Practice and participation in the Lord's Supper has changed drastically over the centuries. Most scholars agree both from what is written in the scriptures and from extra biblical historical writings, that the first century church or the early church practiced the Lord's Supper in context of a meal. It wasn't it wasn't just a little piece of bread and a little cup of juice. And I'm not trying to say anything bad about what we're doing, but it was in the context of a meal. It was something they shared together. And it wasn't about that it was a physical nourishment. Jesus said, man shall not live on bread alone. But it was about coming together and sharing a meal together and remembering what Christ had done. In later centuries, it really changed and got to the point where only the clergy or the priests participated in the Lord's Supper because they deemed themselves the only ones holy enough to participate. And there was a lot of years where that was the case. And I remember taking a course that showed how architecture changed. The earliest buildings were centered around the Lord's table. And then later, the buildings started, they kind of moved the table away and there was a place for the congregation. And then it got moved even further and there was actually this division between the people and the priests. And it was totally removed. The people just, if they could see it, it was the backsides of the priests. And so that was one of the huge things of the Reformation movement in the 1600s, was taking the Lord's Supper back for the people, for the priesthood of all believers. That's extremely significant. So as traditions for how we practice and participate in the Lord's Supper have changed over the centuries, I believe maybe we have lost some of the awe and wonder about what is really happening when we gather around to eat and participate in the Lord's Supper. We're going to start with Luke 22 here. Luke 22, the 14th verse. And when the hour had come, he reclined at the table and the apostles with him, and he said to them, I have earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, and there's an example right there of the Lord's Supper being instituted but in context of a meal. The Passover was a meal. I say to you, I shall never again eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And when he had taken a cup and given thanks, he said, take this and share it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine from now on until the kingdom of God comes. And when he had taken some bread and given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, he took the cup after they had eaten, saying, this cup, which is poured out for you, is the new covenant in my blood. I want you to notice that phrase, the new covenant in my blood, because it's particularly important. The word new has a couple meanings, right? One is brand new or different, right? The other meaning for new is what? A replacement of something old. Which did Jesus mean when he used the words new covenant? Replacement of something old. The old covenant was the Mosaic covenant I referred to earlier that was established, if you remember, after God brought the Israelites out of Egypt through the Red Sea and to the holy mountain, Mount Sinai. And we're going to Exodus 24, verses 3 through 11. Then Moses came and recounted to the people all the words of the Lord and all the ordinances. And all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words which the Lord has spoken, we will do. And Moses wrote down all the words of the Lord. Then he arose early in the morning and built an altar at the foot of the mountain with 12 pillars for the 12 tribes of Israel. And he sent young men of the sons of Israel, and they offered burnt offerings and sacrificed young bulls as peace offerings to the Lord. And Moses took half of the blood and put it in basins, and the other half of the blood he sprinkled on the altar. Then he took the book of the covenant and read it in the hearing of the people, and they said, all that the Lord has spoken we will do, and we will be obedient. So Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people and said, behold, the blood of the covenant, which the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words. You see that connection? The old covenant was established by the blood of bulls But Jesus was establishing the new covenant by what? By his own blood. Now what happened after, right after that was established is awesome. And it really underscores the importance of this Lord's Supper and the connection of fellowship in the Lord's Supper. Verses 9 and 10 and 11. Then Moses went up with Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel. And they saw the God of Israel. And under his feet there appeared to be a pavement of sapphire, as clear as the sky itself. Yet he did not stretch out his hand against the nobles of the sons of Israel. Because remember, there's a few times you read that no man may see the face of God and live. And so they saw God, yet he did not stretch out his hand. I lost my spot. Oh, and they beheld God, and what does it say? They ate and drank. Can you imagine? That is so awesome. Can you imagine eating a meal in God's presence? That meal was just the first of many meals. Although the Israelites never saw God again like Moses and the 70 elders did, God's promise to the Israelites was that he would go with them and be with them. And he kept his promise. How? His presence dwelt where? In the tabernacle and later in the temple. And God established many sacrifices and feasts in which the Israelites were to come back together and feast together before God. If you read the Old Testament and you read about some of those feasts, you'll see over and over that they were supposed to eat them before God, in the presence of God, because his presence dwelt among them. So in this context, when Jesus institutes this new meal, this new supper with the disciples and then with the Jews afterwards as they were converted, they would understand the context of this. And that this is a supper in which we share and fellowship together, but we share and fellowship together in the body and the blood of Christ. 1 Corinthians 10, which I don't have up there, says, "Is not the cup of blessing which we bless a sharing in the blood of Christ? Is not the bread which we break a sharing in the body of Christ? Since there is one bread, we who are many are one body, for we all partake of the one bread." And we come back again to this oneness, and that our fellowship should have unity, and we're breaking down barriers. Participating in the Lord's Supper is an important time of fellowship, fellowship with each other, and it's fellowship with God. So, we can enter into fellowship with God through what he imparts to us in baptism. And today is the day. If you haven't entered into the water and haven't entered into fellowship with God, then there's no better day than today. And it's not just because the baptistry is finally fixed. In just a moment, we'll sing another song before we participate in the Lord's Supper. And if you need to respond, you can respond at that time. Or you can call during the week. We can remain in fellowship with God by walking and living in the light. And if we have entered the water and we are followers of Christ, if there's some area of our lives in which we are living in darkness, then today is the day to confess and to turn and walk in the light. And finally, we can fellowship with God by sitting at this table and participating in the Lord's Supper together. And I was thinking earlier, all the youth can come to the stage. Tom is, which I didn't do this morning, but each of the weeks in the series, he's urged us to come together to these two center aisles. And if you think about it, what do you do when you eat a meal? Does your family split to the ends of the house. You come around a table together. Because why? Well, most of the time we like each other. But I mean, I think that's kind of the same idea. If we like each other, we ought to feel comfortable enough to be close to each other. And maybe that's where fellowship can lead us. But so we really look forward to this time of sharing together around the Lord's table.
The friendship and affection I need to feel my Father smiling on me. Yours is the name.
Meet around the table, we partake of the cup as it's passed. Each one who is with Christ is welcome to partake. Our compassionate Christ, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. Luke 23:34. Have you ever wondered how Christ kept from retaliating against the mob that killed him? Have you ever asked how he kept his control? Here's the answer. It's this statement, for they do not know what they are doing. look carefully, it's as if Christ considered this bloodthirsty, death-hungry crowd not as murderers, but as being confused. It's as if he regarded them not as a militant mob, but as he put it, sheep without a shepherd. They don't know what they are doing. And when you think about it, they didn't. They hadn't the faintest idea what they were doing. They were a stir-crazy crowd, mad at something they couldn't see, so they took it out on, of all people, God. But they didn't know what they were doing. Father God, we thank you. Thank you for Christ, who was willing to go to the cross for us. We who are guilty are made perfect in his sight. We pray, Father, that you guide and direct each one of us in our life for Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.